Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Gopi Jana Ballabha Girivada Dhari. Gopi Jana Ballabha Girivada Dhari. Yashoda Nandana Vraja Janarandana Yashoda Nandana Vraja Janarandana Yashoda Nandana Vraja Janarandana Yashoda Nandana Vraja Janaranjana Jamuna Tira Vanachari Jamuna Tira Vanachari Jai Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Jai Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Gopi Jana Ballabha Girivada Dhari Gopi Jana Ballabha Girivada Dhari Yashoda Nandana Vraja Janaranjana Yashoda Nandana Vraja Janaranjana Yashoda Nandana Vraja Janaranjana Yashoda Nandana Vraja Janaranjana Jamuna Tira Vanachari Jamuna Tira Vanachari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari J Jayam Vishnupad Paramahamsa Prabhupada Jashtotara Shishimada Bhai Charanada Vinda Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Jayam Vishnupad Paramahamsa Prabhupada Jashtotara Shishimada Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Maharaj Ki Jai. Ananta Koti Vaishnavinda Ki Jai. Nama Acharya Srila Haridas Thakur Ki Jai. Prem Skoho Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Garad Hara Shivas Hari Gaur Bhaktivinda Ki Jai. Shri Shri Radha Krishna Gopa Gopina Shamakunda Radha Kund Giri Govardhan Ki Shri Vrindavan Tham Ki Shri Mayapur Navadeep Dham Ki Shri Jagannath Puri Ki Tulsi Devi Bhakti Devi Ki Jamuna Devi Ganga Devi Ki Samaveta Bhakti Vrinda Ki. All glorious to the assembled devotees. All glorious to the assembled devotees. All glorious to the assembled devotees. Go Premanande Hari Go. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskritya. Naram Chaiva Narottamam. Devim Sarasatim Vyasam. Tato Jaya Mudiraye. We're continuing our reading of the Srimad Bhagavatam. We're now in canto number 8. And the chapter is number 2. We heard recently, within the last few days from the Bhagavatam, this same section about Gajendra, the elephant, and he was set for life and a beautiful area of the universe and had a healthy family and an altogether opulent situation for an elephant. Everyone respected him and got out of his way wherever he was going. He was the big man on campus. And one day when he was taking a bath with his family, a crocodile grabbed onto his leg and wouldn't let go. And for 1,000 years, Gajendra and the crocodile fought. And because the crocodile was an animal of the water, it gained strength by being in the water, and Gajendra, being an animal of the land, lost strength over time. And Gajendra came to a point where he realized his helplessness. His family had tried to save him, friends had tried to save him, and he realized finally that there was no one else to save him except for a higher power. And although he wasn't completely aware of who that higher power was, as this is revealed later when he offers his prayers, in a heartfelt way he began to call out to the Lord. And the prayers that he recited in that helpless condition were ones that he remembered from a previous life, the life just before becoming an elephant, when he was a king. And at that time, as a sophisticated and highly advanced spiritual person, he would recite prayers every day. And we read how it's important for us to recite various prayers, besides chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, which we should do from the heart every day, and with a set number in order to gain strength. We need to gain strength. Takes practice. When a baby learns to walk, it needs to grab onto the couch, it needs to grab onto somebody's pant leg, fall down, get back up. And over time, with the struggle, gradually begins to walk. The walking capacity is innate, but it comes out after some time with encouragement and practice. And when we come into this world, we have potential, but it needs to be directed. One needs guidance from a spiritual master, from the Shastra, and one has to put in one's own effort to come up to standard of nishta, or strength, by which one can stand on one's own two feet spiritually without being disturbed by unnecessary necessities. There are many unnecessary necessities that the mind conjures. As Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, the mind is a factory that makes these, conjures ideas about what I need. But one who is situated in nishta has a clear idea and experience, has tasted for him or herself that everything I need is already within me. This is a stable position in spiritual life, and therefore when the unnecessary necessities appear in my mind or conjured by my mind or bubble up because of my past experience, they bubble up because I've taken them before, and by the law of nature, one aspect of karma is once I touch something in this material world, sense gratification, it comes back later and says, take it again. And even if I've changed my mind since then, it insists and says, no, take it again. And you have to be twice as strong the second time. And if you give in the second time, then you have to be three times as strong the next time. And after many lifetimes, there are competing desires which bubble up and say, take me again. So through the power of spiritual practice, repeating the holy names of the Lord, associating with the devotees, hearing Srimad Bhagavatam in the association of devotees, worshipping the deity, visiting holy places, doing seva, one can actually develop a predisposition for spiritual happiness and be disinclined towards the desires that are residuals from previous sense gratificatory activities. So Krishna says in the Gita, all that you do to advance yourself spiritually is permanent. And all that you do to advance yourself materially is temporary. Indradyumna Maharaj was in an advanced condition materially in his last life. He was a king. And spiritually, he was also advanced. But the part that remained was the spiritual advancement. When he took birth in his next life, he was an elephant, from a king to an elephant. Prabhupada once, in observing people, told the devotees he was having a conversation with that experience in this material body is that after performing a lifetime of wanton sense gratification, death is like this. Go to sleep as a man, wake up as a dog. Actually, frightened me when I heard that. Just, it sounds like a light thing. In fact, college students often would say to Prabhupada, and still do say, what's the difference? What do I care if I become a dog in my next life? But for one who's actually seeing that I have a rare opportunity in this human life to advance spiritually and to become free from the prison-like situation of the material world, it's precarious to dally with sense gratification. And the prospect of going to sleep as a man, waking up as a dog, and losing that opportunity, the Vedas say, is the most fearful situation possible. In fact, they describe it as killing the soul. Atmaha, one who doesn't take full advantage is a killer of the soul. Asurya namate loka andhena tamasavrita tamste pratyabhigachanti eke chatma hanojanaha. The person who disregards spiritual life, takes the life of sense gratification, ends up killing his soul. And Krishna says, Ashradhana purusha dharmasyasya parantapa aprapyamam nivartante mrityusam saravartmani. A person who becomes faithless, who doesn't follow the scripture, and gives up the progressive march towards the Supreme Personality of Godhead, enters back onto the path of birth and death. That's the result. Mrityu samsara, vartmani. His vartma is mrityu and samsara. But a person who practices spiritual life, especially very seriously, well, even if not seriously, even a little bit, Krishna says, that remains. But for those who understand the opportunity and take it very seriously, success is guaranteed. So Gajendra, in his last life, was a king named Indradumna, and he used to recite every day prayers. So this is a very recommended process, and very sweet too. If one chooses some prayers from the Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam particularly, and every day recites them, and listens to them, and goes deeply within the word meanings, and thinks about them, one will gain an affinity for them, an attachment that is wholly spiritual, and the vibration itself will purify the heart. Not only that, Srila Prabhupada says, if you happen to not end up where you wanted to end up after this human life, he said, anyone of my disciples somehow or other becomes an animal, because anything can happen, you have these shlokas, you'll remember them in your next life, even if you become an animal. And the proof is of Gajendra. So we left off when he was in this precarious situation, in the clutches of the crocodile, and his friends and wives had tried to help him. And we take up at verse number 33. That's 8:2:33. Yakash chani sho balinon takoragat prachanda vigad abhidhavato brasham bhitam prapannam paripati yad bayan mrityu pradavat yaranam ta imahi. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is certainly not known to everyone, but he is very powerful and influential. Therefore, although the serpent of eternal time, which is fearful in force, endlessly chases everyone, ready to swallow him, if one who fears this serpent seeks shelter of the Lord, the Lord gives him protection, for even death runs away in fear of the Lord. I therefore surrender unto him, the great and powerful supreme authority, who is the actual shelter of everyone. Purport. One who is intelligent understands that there is a great and supreme authority above everything. That great authority appears in different incarnations to save the innocent from disturbances. As confirmed in Bhagavad Gita 4:8, Paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya chaduskritam. The Lord appears in his various incarnations for two purposes: to annihilate the duskriti, the sinful, and to protect his devotees. The king of the elephants decided to surrender unto him. This is intelligent. One must know that great supreme personality of Godhead and surrender unto him. The Lord comes personally to instruct us how to be happy, and only fools and rascals do not see by intelligence the supreme authority, the supreme person. In the Shruti mantra it is said, Bish Bishasmad Vatapavate Bishodati Surayaha Bishasmad Agnish Chandrascha Mrityudavati Panchamaha from the Taittiriya Upanishad. It is out of fear of the Supreme Personality of Godhead that the wind is blowing, that the sun is distributing heat and light, and that death is chasing everyone. Thus there is a Supreme Controller as confirmed in Bhagavad Gita 9.10. Maya dakshena prakriti suyate sarat sacharacharam. This material manifestation is working so well because of the Supreme Controller. Any intelligent person, therefore, can understand that there is a Supreme Controller. Furthermore, the Supreme Controller himself appears as Lord Krishna, as Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and as Lord Ramachandra to give us instructions and to show us by example how to surrender unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Yet those who are duskriti, the lowest of men, do not surrender. Namam duskritinu muda prapadyante naradama. Now this is a wonderful fact, and that is that Krishna instructs us to surrender to him. Where does he do that? In the Bhagavad Gita, right? Sarva dharman parityaja mamekam sharanam raja hantvang sarva papebhyo mokshay shami masuchaha. After he's given all the instructions in the Bhagavad Gita, at the very end he says, now just abandon all other dharmas and surrender to me. And the Bhagavatam says, devarshi bhutap dandrinam pitranam nakinkaro nayam ranicha rajan saravatmanaya sharanam sharanyam kato mukundam parihritakartam. And that is, you're a debtor in this world to the devas, the rishis, the pitris, to all kinds of living entities who have been maintaining you and are responsible for helping you. However, if you surrender to the Supreme Personality of God at Mukunda, you're no longer rini, you're no longer a debtor, because your debts are absolved. Similar to what Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita. And we see an example of Arjuna surrendering to Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita. He changes his relationship. He's friendly with Krishna and familiar with Krishna. And then when he becomes bewildered and doesn't know what to do, he shows by example that now I surrender and I accept Krishna as my spiritual master. And then the mood changes. He becomes reverent, begins to inquire from him and so forth. The path of surrender is chalked out by our very recent acharyas, the Goswamis, who describe it as a sixfold path, accepting those things which are favorable for devotional service, rejecting those things that are unfavorable, considering the Lord to be one's exclusive maintainer, try that for a day, exclusive protector, considering oneself to be very insignificant, be meek and humble, and finally, atmanivedanam, or giving everything to Krishna, giving one's entire self, the sixfold path of surrender. So surrender is the highest goal for the living entity in this world, and it solves all of his problems to surrender to Krishna. However, still, even after hearing all these instructions and the example of Arjuna, it's difficult for people to surrender. In the teachings of Lord Chaitanya, Srila Prabhupada mimics the voice of a person attached to the material world. Why me surrender? Give up? And give up being kicked by Maya? Why should I give up my position here? And Krishna himself comes and shows the path of surrender. He accepts spiritual master. Ramachandra accepts spiritual master. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, in his pastimes, was very puffed up when he was a youth, full of knowledge. Went around defeating everybody. Went to Gaya, accepted his spiritual master. After taking Diksha, he came back a very humbled person. And from that point, he began to make great spiritual progress after he took initiation from his spiritual master, Srila Ishwarapuri. And if you'll hand me Adi Lila Volume 1, there's explication in the Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita about the importance of this kind of surrender. Rupa Goswami mentions in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, out of all the 64 items of devotional service, three are primary. Adau Guru Vashrayam, take shelter of a guru. Sudharma Pritsha, you should inquire submissively. And the first chapter of the Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita talks about the spiritual master. And Srila Prabhupada writes in 135, "One should always remember that a person who is reluctant to accept the spiritual master and be initiated is sure to be baffled in his endeavor to go back to Godhead. One who is not properly initiated may present himself as a great devotee, but in fact he is sure to encounter many stumbling blocks on his path of progress towards spiritual realization, with the result that he must continue his term of material existence without relief. Such a helpless person is compared to a ship without a rudder, for such a ship can never reach its destination. It is imperative, therefore, that one accept a spiritual master if he at all desires to gain the favor of the Lord. The service of the spiritual master is essential." So there's a lot of explanation in the first chapter, which is named the spiritual masters. Talks about that. It's the means in which one approaches Krishna through the spiritual master. And he mentions several types of spiritual masters: the Vartman Pradakshaka, guru who introduces one to the path of spiritual life, the Shiksha Guru, and the Diksha Guru. And all of these, he says, are agents of Krishna. The way in which you locally surrender to Krishna and take shelter. So Krishna does this. Lord Chaitanya does it when he comes. He accepts a spiritual master. So does Krishna himself. Who's Krishna's spiritual master? Sandipani Muni. And Lord Ramachandra? Yeah, so all of the incarnations of the Lord accept a spiritual master to show the example. And this is in the process of surrender. So Srila Prabhupada has brought this out in his purport. And he continues, "In Bhagavad Gita, the Lord clearly says, Mrityu sarva harashchaham, I am all devouring death. Thus Mrityu, or death, is the representative who takes everything away from the living entity who has accepted a material body. No one can say, I do not fear death. This is a false proposition. Everyone fears death. However, one who seeks shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead can be saved from death. One may argue, does the devotee not die? The answer is that a devotee certainly must give up his body, for the body is material. The difference is, however, that for one who surrenders to Krishna fully and is protected by Krishna, the present body is his last. He will not again receive a material body to be subjected to death. This is assured in Bhagavad Gita. Tyaktvadeham punarjanma naiti mam eti surjuna. A devotee, after giving up his body, does not accept a material body, but returns home back to Godhead. We are always in danger because at any moment death can take place. It is not that only Gajendra, the king of the elephants, was afraid of death. Everyone should fear death because everyone is caught by the crocodile of eternal time and may die at any moment. The best course, therefore, is to seek shelter of Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and be saved from the struggle for existence in this material world, in which one repeatedly takes birth and dies. To reach this understanding is the ultimate goal of life." Thus end the Bhaktivedanta purports of the 8th canto, 2nd chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, entitled The Elephant Gajendra's Crisis. And now we'll take some reflections about anything you heard so far. Sri Kumar Prabhu.
Thank you. Thank you, Prabhuji. Here, Prabhupada had written that intelligent people take very, very well understand who the supreme controller is. But if we see in our offices, they are seemingly very intelligent people, but they don't really know who the supreme, or don't even, I mean, they are in the atheist categories or and agnostic categories. So how is it that they're seemingly intelligent, Prabhuji, but they're not?
How is it what?
How is it that they're seemingly intelligent, but they can't easily understand that there has to be a controller beyond them?
Well, there are different kinds of intelligence in this world. As has been identified, there's one way of measuring intelligence as a quotient called IQ. And there are tests in which you can measure against other people's capacity to solve problems on paper. And then there are, recently, other people have written about emotional intelligence, which is one's ability to communicate with others. For instance, there are people who are brilliant as far as IQ is concerned, but are dysfunctional when it comes to society. Some of you are smiling. Maybe you know somebody like that. That somebody is very, very bright, but then doesn't know how to relate to other people. And the theory of emotional intelligence talks about measuring people's intelligence in terms of how they're able to negotiate the real world around them, relationships with other people, and their communication skills. So even in this world, secularly, we can understand there's different kinds of intelligence. But so real intelligence isn't based just on problem solving. But Krishna describes that if one is humble, amanivam, adambibam, himsa, shantirajavam, he mentions 20 items that lead to real intelligence, real knowledge, real wisdom. That is humility, pridelessness, nonviolence. How do all those fit in? Well, if one is humble, and one should be, because anyone in this world is very limited in his ability to understand even the environment around us. People can only study one tiny category of knowledge in a university, for instance, even if they're very bright. Or if maybe they're a double major, or they look into a few categories of knowledge. But even within that, they can only look at a tiny little slice. So those who are actually intelligent are those who understand that this world is unlimited, and I'm very tiny. And they become humble. Amanidvam, adambitvam, ahimsa shantirajavam, acharyopasanam. See, one therefore accepts the authority of acharyas and so forth. So, just Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, maya pritajnana, there's a way in which people who can become very learned, even in the Vedas, because of their unwillingness in their heart to accept a supreme being, they have a hard knot in the heart, their intelligence becomes lost. They lose all their real perspective, whereas a simple person who may not do well in an IQ test, whose heart is simple, they just accept there's God, becomes situated in the highest position. In the 13th chapter of the Gita, Krishna describes how some people have the tendency to listen to authorities. Can I have that? I don't think it's in there. You'll have to get the Gita. Some people have the tendency to listen to authorities, and if they listen to Krishna and they just have that propensity, then suddenly they become liberated. That's intelligent. That's fortunate. So we measured intelligence in a different way, but a short answer to your question is that real intelligence has to do with the state of one's heart. Is a person humble? There it is. Thank you. Again, there are those who, although not conversant in spiritual knowledge, begin to worship the Supreme Person upon hearing about Him from others. Because of their tendency to hear from authorities, they also transcend the path of birth and death. So why can't they do it? They're unfortunate. Why can't they accept God? They're unfortunate. So they have to become fortunate. And that requires some contact with the dust from the lotus feet of devotees, some agata sukriti, some contact that helps to purify. Daksha is a figure in the Bhagavatam who is very intelligent. That's what his name means, expert. But what was he expert in? Material activities, karmakanda. He couldn't appreciate Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva is all gyan and all renunciation. Gyan goes with an renunciation. When you have so much knowledge, you go, like, why am I going to touch anything? You just like, I don't want anywhere near the material world. He doesn't even wear clothes. He just puts ashes on to remind him that the whole material world's temporary. But Daksha couldn't appreciate that at all. He could only appreciate karma. Very expert, very intelligent, couldn't appreciate Lord Shiva, and certainly such a person can't appreciate bhakti very much either. They have the tendency towards being attached to the material world. Although Daksha offered some nice prayers to the Lord, still, he's held back. There's an anchor that's still here in the material world. So real intelligence means to have the state of heart in which one can accept the Supreme and surrender to Him. That may, to modern people in academic circles, sound archaic, almost completely backward. But it's actually not. And I've had my own personal experience. I grew up in a family of academics that was highly valued in my family. If you went to college and got a degree, and my parents were both academics. But I saw later on when death came that their hearts changed, their personalities changed, and they looked at things in a completely different way, especially with my mother. My father had Alzheimer's, so it was a little harder to tell, but my mother's full faculty, but in the last few months of her life, she really changed. What do I mean by changed? She was oriented academically when I became a devotee when I was in high school. And oftentimes we would have discussions, especially when I was overzealous when I first joined. I looked at some of the letters I wrote her, which were probably a little immature. But still, over time, I could see that she and my father, or brother and sister, all academics, they weren't that interested in talking about the absolute truth. My mother was a sociologist, so she'd love to talk to me about the sociological implications of the Hare Krishna movement and so forth. But as far as talking about a supreme being and going into that realm of intelligent discussion, there was a blockade. But before she left, I saw her let go of that about 3 months before she passed away. My father died before she did. They were married for 70 years. And she, you know, she lost all of the frame of reference that had held together her mental construct of how the world works and how there's no God and so forth, really came apart. And I could see, just like Gajendra, you know, everything came apart. He had everything together. It's like, this is the Mayic vision of the world. It's like, this is my house, and this is my job, and my money is over here. The brain accounts for all these things and makes a composite and says, this is me. It's not actually you. It's what it is a reflection of your desires in the material world. You impose yourself on, I impose myself on material nature by looking at it and connecting to it through desire. because I actually have nothing to do with it. Yes, it was Malini who was telling me about leaving her house and moving to another house, and how, of course, her attachment to her house was spiritual because she had had her initiation there. We had many programs there, and she was thinking, this house is, it's very special, I don't want to leave it. And of course it is. But she said about 4 hours after they sold the house and the paper was signed, it just sort of, the whole idea of that's my house, it just evaporated, it was gone. And that's the way of material desires and the material construct that I make by projecting myself into these various people and items in the material world. And so that construct can come apart, that intellectual construct where I say there is no God, it can actually come apart at a certain time, especially if one has some good association. One can let go of that and then take shelter. It's happened many times. Keshav Bharti Maharaj's mother was very much against him becoming a devotee. And later on, when he went to take care of her when she was leaving her body, there was no one else to take care of her, so he came back from India and went to that small town. He's from a small town up in Northern California. He went there with his dhoti and his shaved head, and thought, guess who just came to town? And they weren't sure about him at first either, because they thought maybe he was coming there just to get his mother's money or something. Not that she had much. But actually, he made friends with everybody in the town and the priest at the church and everything, like the pastor of the church and so forth. But he told how she gradually transformed from being against Krishna consciousness to gradually, she had a change of heart. She became a devotee, took initiation before she died from Shivaram Maharaj over the phone. She had cancer, couldn't go anywhere. But that was the change of heart. And that happens. Thing is, better to have that change of heart early on, if one can accommodate that early on, rather than waiting till the last minute. I mean, the last minute it'll do if it's all you have. Like Maharaj Katvanga is mentioned in the Shastra, to show that spiritual life is so potent that if you make up your mind at the last minute, you see, he was busy, really busy, doing his work. And then he got some bonus from the demigods. They said, we'll give you a bonus. He said, the only bonus I want to know when I'm going to die. They said, well, your time's up in about a minute. That was powerful information. He said, okay, I surrender now. Now I surrender. But you want to beat it to the punch. Better a lifetime, Prahlad Maharaj says, start when you're five. Start komara acharet pragno dharmam bhagavatam iha. Start early. Start when you're five. Start now. Don't wait till tomorrow or tonight. Do it now. This minute. Surrender. Remember Gajendra. The crocodile, if you're intelligent, you'll understand the crocodile is already there. He's already on me. Don't wait till it becomes so obvious that, you know, you're forced to do this. Okay, yes, sorry. Go ahead.
Dandavat Maharaj. Maharaj, for me, I found a bit bewildering that a devotee of Indradyumna caliber could actually become an elephant. So, of course, it's not his karma, right? He's the person who got the deities of Jagannath, Baldev, Subhadra, and he became like this. So it seems very unpredictable. Like at points we have devotees like whom you mentioned, Katvanga Maharaj and Ajamila. Within a moment they actually get Krishna, and here we have this. So it seems almost like a lottery, very unpredictable. So yeah, it almost actually makes me think, if that is his state, then what is position for me? And So
it's not a mathematical or a mechanical formula. Every living entity has his or her own attachment to this material world and a perfect process for becoming extricated from it and going back to Godhead. And Krishna knows what that is. And for those, Prabhupada said, who are very serious, there's a way in which Krishna sometimes keeps them a little extra time in the material world to give them even more purification. Yeah. Even more purification, because going back to Godhead is not a plaything, Prabhupada says, in the light of the Bhagavad. And there's a way in which this incident with King Indradumna becoming an elephant was very purifying for him. It was a shortcut, actually. You may say, oh, how did he become an elephant? It was all planned. It was planned like that, and it came through a sage. The sage cursed him, and now he becomes an elephant. This is actually a fast track, but the fact is, asanga shastrena jritena chitva, Krishna says in the Gita, cut off this tree. How are you going to do that? It's not so easy. Unless there's a really strong impetus, unless the perfect situation is there for you, set up for you to make that final, complete surrender. That's part of the story here. He's put in a situation. It's actually very fortunate. Same thing with Nalakuvera and Manigriva. They were given that situation. So we don't know what is in the heart of each person and also Krishna's special arrangement. Even the Gandharva got this benediction curse. Doesn't say exactly in the storyline, but Prabhupada says he went back to Godhead. Made a stop in the Gandharva Loka before he went there. So, really, to try to interpret in each particular case is not very fruitful. Best to see actually that it's really a rare thing for people to completely surrender, but Krishna gives this kind of facility to special devotees. Jad Bharat and was started off as Bharat Maharaj. The whole subcontinent of India is named after him because he was such a great soul. And what did he have to go through? Not that much compared to what he got. And that's where Prabhupada mentions it, in relationship to Bharat Maharaj, that there's a way in which, by that extra couple of lives, I mean, look at, and as I mentioned before, Judd Bharat, what a hero. I love hearing the story of Judd Bharat. He comes out, and it's like, that's it. I don't care what anybody says. I mean, it's like, I didn't want to be known as, it's really hard, you know, if you have full facility, you know, to say, like, I want to be known as a dull stone. I don't want to be known as a great orator or as a great devotee or anything. I want to be known as the opposite so I can be just completely focused on Krishna. There's this resolution in the heart that has to come about. And Krishna makes the perfect arrangement for each person. And he knows what it is that is rooted, what I have rooted subtly. Even after I surrender, there's a way in which there's some residual. Because as mentioned in the very famous purport to Tate Anukampam Susamikshamano, famous Bhagavatam commentator Sridhar Swami says, there's a way in which even after one surrenders, there's still a residual effect of desire in the heart. And Krishna knows what it is. Nobody else may know. Everyone else may know. Wow, look at that person. But Krishna knows, there it is, right there. How are you going to get rid of that last vestiges? Krishna knows. How about become an elephant next life? Or whatever it takes to make that final break. I mean, going back to Godhead, that's it. That's the thing. You know, who cares what it takes? That's the mood of the devotee. Who cares what it takes? You know, let's get it done. And if you're willing to pray like that and say, Krishna, let's get this done, please. Then you got some heavy praying going on. Your life turns into an exhilarating experience rather than an indirect kind of experience of maybe I'll put my little toe in. Some people, when they go to the lake, you know, they'll stand around for half an hour and everyone's, get in here! And they're like, and somebody like, so Krishna can do that. May not look pretty, but yes.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. I just wanted to share, today there was a small earthquake actually at in Fremont, I think 2.5 on the Richter scale. At that juncture, you know, Shamalangi was at home and I was, so I, she said, did you feel? I said, yes. But then suddenly I felt like if that scale would have been a little higher, that would have been it. You know, that would have been it. And we take it for granted that I'm going to live forever. You know, since we survived, there's no need to get out. And, you know, because that tendency in our mind is there, I'm not going to die, I'm going to stay forever. But then there was a realization, no, it can happen at any moment. And it's very well, as you explained today.
This is Gajendra Katha, right? I mean, it's like, what lessons are you teaching tonight? This is it. I mean, if you have that sense of urgency, and that's what we're meant to get from hearing Gajendra, that this is serious, and I'm in a serious situation, and I should take it seriously. You know, you can see it in the eyes of somebody. I just remember one devotee, a godbrother of mine, I remember him, how he, one night, I was coming out of the Brahmacharya ashram in Los Angeles, and I was going to do some other service. He was running across the street. Where are you going? Evening program, got to be there. And just in a couple of seconds, I saw the intensity in his eyes to make sure that he was there at the evening program. Didn't want to miss it. I mean, morning program, everyone has to be there on time. After over some years, it became evening program, optional. But he was like, I have to be there on time. And just seeing that in the eyes of another devotee, you can remember the serious business that we're engaged in. Take it seriously. Krishna says, "Ye yata mam prapadyante tamstataiva bhajamyaham." You take it seriously, I give you special facility to advance. What else? Other things you heard that stuck? Yes, there's some on the internet. We welcome everyone who's joined us on the internet tonight for the universal community of hearing and chanting. Hare Krishna.
There are two texts, Maharaj.
Yes.
One is from Bhakta Raphael. Hare Krishna. Please accept my heartfelt obeisances and humble dandavats. All glories to Srila Prabhupada and to you as well, my dear Gurudev. The most simple and honest action we can do is to surrender to Krishna. With sincerity and pure devotion, association with the devotees, listen to the Shastras, chant with passion and sincerely, follow our spiritual master's instructions and be humble, is the only way to break the chain that attaches us to this material existence and puts us on the platform that we want to be. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you, Bhakta Raphael.
Thank you very much for a wonderful class. Many points I like. One was just recently when you brought the point of Jad Bharat. So today only I think I saw one of my colleagues is like very serious. So I always said, why is very serious? Then I remember Jad Bharat. Yeah, this is reminds me of Jad Bharat, like how he should be. And it was his quality I was just remembering Jad Bharat that time. That yeah, he reminds me of Jad Bharat. So. And second thing, I was that intelligence that Prabhu asked the question, I was remembering your favorite words that you always quote, that Kama Dinam. That in which he says that what is the real intelligence at the last. And third thing, you are mentioning the prayers, how it is so important. And just over the period, if we repeat the prayers from Bhagavatam or Bhagavad Gita, we start developing a special relationship, going deeper into the verses. So that is very practical advice, and I like that very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Favorite verse, eh? Well, someone asked me what my favorite verse is, and I've been thinking about it for the last 2 days. I don't think it's every verse is my favorite verse. How could I stop at one and say, this is my favorite verse? Because everyone I think of, I think, yeah, that's my favorite. No, I like this one. I mean, each one, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta once was asked after a feast, which preparation did you like the best? He said, each one was better than the next. Okay, couple more. Yes, Jirash.
Yes, Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Really good points that I heard recently. So you mentioned change of heart and sense of urgency. Any recommendations how to develop that within ourselves first, and also when we interact with the world, we meet many people who are actually kind on a material platform, but are not that spiritually inclined towards Krishna consciousness. So how to develop these essential qualities?
Well, sense of urgency, you can do with your intelligence. Change of heart takes a little association, really good association. But intelligence, by intelligence, you can create a sense of urgency. Even in material planning, if you actually chalk out what you have to do, instead of procrastinating and going mindless, because that's one way to procrastinate. You just become mindless and zone off into something else and then forget about all your responsibilities. But if you actually inventory everything that you have to do, that you have to get done in the next week, and write it down, actually, it's a state of urgency, but it's a productive state, and you'll become more... You'll be able to face it in a very practical way. So similarly, if you look at your life and you inventory how much time you likely have left, how much time you're obligated to spend doing other things that might distract you from your spiritual practice and so forth, and then be very clear about your goal, then you'll develop a sense of urgency. You can develop that through a little planning and intelligence. And a change of heart requires mercy. And you get mercy from, especially from Vaishnavas, who are like desire trees. And if you approach them, even if you don't have that impetus in your heart to serve Krishna, if you serve the devotees and you pray to the devotees, then by their mercy you can get it. Example, precedent, Narada Muni. He was a small child, came from a very ordinary kind of background, nondescript. In fact, at that time, it was considered sort of not very exalted, to say the least. But because sadhus came and stayed at his house and they accommodated him, his mother accommodated sadhus staying there, and he was respectful to them. And one time, appreciating them, he asked them if he could just have a little remnant from their plate, one grain of rice, like that. They said, take. He took it. He had a change of heart. It's all described there. Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, he was very fixed in his way. He had thousands of disciples. He was the most intelligent logician in all of India. He was fixed in his philosophy, had the whole construct. Then he met this 24-year-old sannyasi and tried to instruct him in how to be a real sannyasi. And then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu changed his heart just in a matter of a week or 10 days by being around him. His heart changed. So try to serve great devotees and make an inventory of your life. Those two things will help, in my humble opinion. Two more texts.
This is from Hansa Priya Mataji.
Hansa Priya.
Hare Krishna. I'm going to take the point of practice to allow Krishna to be maintainer for one day.
Very nice. Yeah, good to take things one day at a time, because we can think of these things in abstract terms and think how Krishna can be the maintainer, but better to start now. Do it for one day, even an hour, see what happens. Thank you, Hansapriya. Go ahead.
And this is Varshana Mataji.
Varshana.
Hare Krishna, Shri Guru Maharaji, Danvat Pranam. I like this a lot. Unnecessary necessities appear in the mind. Having enjoyed in the past, they come back again to tempt, but one has to have stronger resistance to avoid them.
Very good. And by the way, that phrase, unnecessary necessities, is Prabhupada's phrase. I've read it 3 times now, and it's just so brilliant. It's one of those Prabhupada-isms that is so brilliant. He encapsulates in a completely understandable way and his use of the English language. It's just, it penetrates unnecessary necessities. Just think about it, because they almost cancel. It's like an algebraic equation. It cancels itself out. It's like, okay, forget it. There's an unnecessary necessity. And then it becomes null. Okay? Now, let's just hear a little bit more from Gajendra's prayers, because here's his prayers of surrender. Now we know the situation he's in, and we want to empathize with his situation. We want to actually feel that I'm in the grips of the crocodile. And from there, we're going to hear from text one, this recitation, this situation, how he began to say his prayers to the Lord. Sri Shukadeva Goswami continued, "Thereafter, the king of the elephants, Gajendra, fixed his mind in his heart with perfect intelligence and chanted a mantra which he had learned in his previous birth as Indrajumna and which he remembered by the grace of Krishna. Iti Badarayani Ruvacha Evam Vyavasito Pudya Samadhaya Manohridi Jajapa Paramam Japyam Prajanman Anushikshitam Jajapa Paramam Japyam." Jajapa, he chanted Paramam a supreme Japyam, a mantra he had learned. Jajapa Paramam Japyam, that's what you should do every day. Jajapa Paramam Japyam. Someone says, "What are you doing over there?" Says, "Jajapa. Jajapa paramam japyam." Purport. Such remembrance is described in Bhagavad Gita. Tatra tam puti sang yogam labate bhava dehikam yatate chatato puya sansadao kuru nandana purva bhyase nate naiva riyate yavashopi saha. In these verses, it is assured that even if a person engaged in devotional service falls down, he is not degraded, but is placed in a position in which he will, in due course of time, remember the Supreme Personality of Godhead. As explained later, Gajendra was formerly King Indrajumna, and somehow or other in his next life, he became King of the Elephants. Now Gajendra was in danger, and although he was in a body other than that of a human being, he remembered the stotra he had chanted in his previous life. Yatate chatato puya samsidau kuru nandana. To enable one to achieve perfection, Krishna gives one the chance to remember him again. This is proved here. For although the king of the elephants, Gajendra, was put in danger, this was a chance for him to remember his previous devotional activities so that he could immediately be rescued by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. It is imperative, therefore, that all devotees in Krishna consciousness practice chanting some mantra. Certainly one should chant the Hare Krishna mantra, which is the Maha Mantra, or Great Mantra, and also one should practice chanting Chintamani Prakara Sadmasu, or the Nrsingha Stotra, Ito Nrsingha Parato Nrsingho, Yato Yato Yami Tato Nrsingha. Every devotee should practice in order to chant some mantra perfectly, so that even though he may be imperfect in spiritual consciousness in this life, in his next life he will not forget Krishna consciousness, even if he becomes an animal. Of course, the devotee should try to perfect his Krishna consciousness in this life, for simply by understanding Krishna and his instructions, after giving up this body, one can return home back to Godhead. Even if there is some fall down, practice of Krishna consciousness never goes in vain. For example, Ajamil, in his boyhood, practiced chanting the name of Narayan under the direction of his father. But later in his youth, he fell down and became a drunkard, a woman hunter, rogue, and thief. Nonetheless, because of chanting the name of Narayan for the purpose of calling his son, whom he had named Narayan, he became advanced, even though he was involved in sinful activities. Therefore, we should not forget the chanting of the Hare Krishna mantra under any circumstances. It will help us in the greatest danger, as we find in the life of Gajendra. So this is the greatest need of the human being. Human being is meant Kamasya nendriya pritir labo jivete yavata jivasya tattva jignasya narto yash cheha karmabil. One should eat to live, not live to eat. And that's what the verse says. The human life has a very specific purpose. You can have as much sense gratification as you need to stay fit and to stay in sound body and mind enough so that you can go on cultivating spiritual life. That kind of sense gratification is not only allowed, it's necessary to maintain the body and soul together. Anything over that will cause disturbance to the mind and the body and will divert us from the path. So we want to refine the way that we think and work and live so that we're not disturbed by these kinds of extraneous endeavors and desires, and diverted, I should say, by these things. So are you enlivened by this? It's a very practical thing about chanting these mantras. First of all, always chant the Maha Mantra. That should be first and foremost. Without stoppage, the Maha Mantra should go on. The other thing is, one should chant Chintamani Prakara Sadmasu Kalpaviksha. You could take it that you should learn the Brahma Sanghita. So that means you should practice it every day, wherever you go. If you get on a boat, you should chant the Brahma Sanghita. Stand near the edge of the boat. All the other passengers are there, speaking about the scenery going by. You can stand by the engine so they can't hear you so much, and you can just chant the Brahma Sanghita out loud to your heart's content. If you go on a bus, or if you're moving from one city to the next, bring your Brahma Samhita with you and recite the prayers. And when you go on pilgrimage, this comes to be a great way to offer something to the deities when you go to visit them at various holy places. Bring some prayer or mantra. One of the greatest days of my life, when my friend and I, my godbrother, we always chant the Brahma Samhita together every time we're together when we're traveling on pilgrimage. And one day we went to the Radharaman temple and we were there a little bit late for the darshan. We started chanting the Brahma Samhita for the Lord, and about three-fourths of the way through the prayers, the pujaris started getting ready to close the curtains. And we had so much momentum and we were putting so much into it that the head pujari came over. I saw him and he stopped him for a moment. He let the curtain stay open a little longer until we finished the last verses of the Brahma Samhita. And I felt like we had brought something to offer to the deity. And such a nice thing to have, that you work on these things and then you can bring them out when you see the deities and you can recite these prayers. The next verse says, We hear Gajendra speak. So here it is. This sound has been passed down to us, and here's Gajendra speaking what he learned in his last life as Indrajumna, and now he's singing it out to the Lord. Shri Gajendra Vacha Om Namo Bhagavate Tasmai Yata Etach Chidatmakam Purushayari Pijaya Parishaya Bidimahi. The king of the elephants, Gajendra, said, I offer my respectful obeisances unto the Supreme Person, Vasudev. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Because of him, this material body acts due to the presence of spirit, and he is therefore the root cause of everyone. He is worshipable for such exalted persons as Brahma and Shiva. And he has entered the heart of every living being. Let me meditate upon him. Purport. In this verse, the words etach chidatmakam are very important. The material body certainly consists only of material elements, but when one awakens to Krishna conscious understanding, the body is no longer material, but spiritual. The material body is meant for sense enjoyment, whereas the spiritual body engages in the transcendental loving service of the Lord. Therefore, a devotee who engages in the service of the Supreme Lord and who constantly thinks of him should never be considered to have a material body. It is therefore enjoined, Gurushu Naramati, one should stop thinking of the spiritual master as an ordinary human being with a material body. Arche Vishnu Shila Dhi, everyone knows that the deity in the temple is made of stone, but to think that the deity is merely stone is an offense. Similarly, to think of the body of the spiritual master, To think that the body of the spiritual master consists of material ingredients is offensive. Atheists think that devotees foolishly worship a stone statue as God and an ordinary man as the guru. The fact is, however, that by the grace of Krishna's omnipotence, the so-called stone statue of the deity is directly the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and the body of the spiritual master is directly spiritual. A pure devotee who is engaged in unalloyed devotional service should be understood to be situated on the transcendental platform. Sagunan samatityai tan brahmabhuyaya kulpate. Let us therefore offer our respectful obeisances unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead, by whose mercy so-called material things also become spiritual when they are engaged in spiritual activity. Omkar, pranava, is the symbolic sound representation of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Om Tat Sat Iti Nirdesho Brahmanas Tri Vidha Smritaha. The three words Om Tat Sat immediately invoke the Supreme Person. Everyone say? Therefore, Krishna says that he is Omkar in all Vedic mantras, pranava sarva vedeshu. The Vedic mantras are pronounced beginning with Omkar to indicate immediately the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Srimad Bhagavatam, for example, begins with the words Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. There is no difference between the Supreme Personality of Godhead Vasudeva and Omkar, pranava. We should be careful to understand that Omkar does not indicate anything nirakara or formless. Indeed, this verse immediately says, Om Namo Bhagavate, Bhagavan is a person. Thus, Omkar is the representation of the Supreme Person. Omkar is not meant to be impersonal, as the Mayavadi philosophers consider it to be. This is distinctly expressed here by the word Purushaya. The Supreme Truth is addressed by Omkar. The Supreme Truth addressed by Omkar is Purusha, the Supreme Person. He is not impersonal. Unless he is a person, how can he control the great stalwart controllers of this universe? Lord Vishnu, Lord Brahma, and Lord Shiva are the supreme controllers of this universe, but Lord Vishnu is offered obeisances even by Lord Shiva and Lord Brahma. Therefore, this verse uses the word Parishaya, which indicates that the Supreme Personality of Godhead is worshipped by exalted demigods. Parishaya means Parameshvara. Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva are Ishvara's great controllers, but Lord Vishnu is Parameshvara, the supreme controller. Prabhupada used to give the example of an iron rod placed in fire, and it becomes red hot and therefore transformed from its original state of being iron into fire. And if you get touched with that, you don't say, I got touched by an iron bar. You said, I got burned. And in a similar way, when a devotee engages fully in devotional service, Rupa Goswami says, Iha yasya hare ardasye karmana manasa gira. Nikila apyavastasu jivan mukta su uchite. The person, the living entity who has surrendered to Krishna and is engaging body, mind, and speech in Krishna's service 24 hours a day is no longer considered to be a conditioned living entity, but has spiritualized, a spiritualized body. And furthermore, in the discussion in the Chaitanya Charitamrita just after Sanatan Goswami's plan to commit suicide by jumping under the cart of Lord Jagannath, because he thought, my body's diseased, I'm a very unqualified person, I've come here for spiritual benefit, but I'm simply making offenses because of the abominable nature of my diseased body. And he thought, what I'll do is I'll jump in front of the wheel of Jagannath's cart in the presence of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and that way I'll attain perfection. He didn't tell anybody, but one day Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came to the house, the hut of Haridas Thakur, where Sanatana Goswami was also staying, and he said, I do not approve this idea of yours, of jumping in front of the cart, of committing suicide. He also said, if one could attain perfection by committing suicide in this way, I would have done it already millions of times. And in that section, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu goes on to explain how a devotee who surrenders to Krishna, takes up the process of devotional service under the guidance of spiritual master Diksha, no longer has a material body, but he has a spiritualized body called a sadaka deha. It's not your spiritual body, but it's the body that you used to be your material body, but because it's engaged fully in Krishna's service, you've handed it over. Now it becomes spiritualized. And it's a different category called sadaka deha. It's the body of a practitioner who's fully engaged in Krishna's service. And it's spiritualized. And in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Brahmarpanam brahmaha vira brahmagnau brahmanohutam brahmaiva tena gantavya brahmakarma samadhina. How come everyone knows that verse? It's a popular verse, isn't it? It's a food prayer. Before I joined the Hare Krishna movement, I read a book, and in it, there was an author, and he mentioned that verse as a way to offer your food. Yeah. Chapter 4, yeah, it's in the Bhagavad Gita. But it's also, it's a popular verse. There's a lot of verses in the Gita, not everyone in India knows them all, but that verse everyone knows because it's popular. Yeah. So yeah, it means that if whatever you have, if it's engaged in Krishna's service, it becomes spiritualized. So it's remarkable that Gajendra the elephant is offering these prayers. Okay, I'm going to read one more, because it keeps getting thicker as we go. In the next verse, Gajendra says, Yasmin idam yatashchedam yenedam yaidam swayam yosmat parasmach cha paras tam prapadye swayam bhuvam. The Supreme Godhead is the supreme platform on which everything rests, the ingredient by which everything has been produced, and the person who is created and is the only cause of this cosmic manifestation. Nonetheless, he is different from the cause and the result. I surrender unto him, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is self-sufficient in everything. Purport. In the Bhagavad Gita 9.4, the Lord says, Mayata tamidam sarvam jagadavyakta murtina. I am the Supreme Personality of Godhead, but everything rests upon my energy, just as an earthen pot rests on the earth. The place where an earthen pot rests is also earth. Then again, the earthen pot is manufactured by a potter, whose body is a product of earth. The potter's wheel with which the pot is made is an expansion of earth, and the ingredients from which the pot are made are also earth. As confirmed in the Shruti Mantra, Yatova imani bhutani jayante yena jatani jivanti yet prayant ya prayant yabi Samiva Shanti. The original cause of everything is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and after being annihilated, everything enters into him. Prakritim Yanti Mahamikam. Thus, the Supreme Lord, the Personality of Godhead, Lord Ramachandra or Lord Krishna, is the original cause of everything. Ishvara Parama Krishna Sakchidananda Vigraha Anadi Radir Govinda Sarvakarana Karanam. Krishna, who is known as Govinda, is the supreme controller. He has an eternal, blissful, spiritual body. He is the origin of all. He has no other origin, for he is the prime cause of all causes. From Brahma Samhita 5.1. The Lord is the cause of everything, but there is no cause for him. Sarvam kalavidam brahma. Matstani sarva bhutani na chaham teshva vastitaha. Although he is everything, his personality is different from the cosmic manifestation. Text number 4. Yasva manidam nijamaya yarpitam kvachid vipatam kvachatat tarohitam avididrik sakshabayam tadikshate sa mamulo vatumam parat paraha. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, by expanding his own energy, keeps this cosmic manifestation visible, and again sometimes renders it invisible. He is both the supreme cause and the supreme result, the observer and the witness in all circumstances. Thus he is transcendental to everything. May that Supreme Personality of Godhead give me protection. Purport, the Supreme Personality of Godhead has multipotencies, parasya shaktir vividaiva shuyate. Therefore, as soon as he likes, he uses one of his potencies, and by that expansion, he creates this cosmic manifestation. Again, when the cosmic manifestation is annihilated, it rests in him. Nonetheless, he is infallibly the Supreme Observer. Under any circumstances, the Supreme Lord is changeless. He is simply a witness and is aloof from all creation and annihilation. Kalena panchatvamiteshu krishnasho lokeshu paleshu chasarva hetushu tamas tadasid gahanam kabiram yastasya pare bivarajate vibhu. In due course of time, when all the causative and effective manifestations of the universe, including the planets and their directors and maintainers, are annihilated, there is a situation of dense darkness. Above this darkness, however, is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He takes shelter of his lotus feet. Purport, from the Vedic mantras, we understand that the Supreme Personality of Godhead is above everything. He is supreme above the demigods, including Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva. He is the supreme controller. When everything disappears by the influence of his energy, the cosmic situation is one of dense darkness. The Supreme Lord, however, is the sunshine, as confirmed in the Vedic mantras, Adityavarnam tamasah parastad. In our daily experience, when we on earth are in darkness of night, the sun is always luminous somewhere in the sky. Similarly, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Supreme Sun, always remains luminous, even when the entire cosmic manifestation is annihilated in due course of time. Na yasya deva rishaya padam vidur jantu punat korhati gantum iritum yata natasya kritibir vicheshtato duratya yanu kramata samavatu. An artist on stage being covered by attractive dresses and dancing with different movements is not understood by his audience. Similarly, the activities and features of the supreme artist cannot be understood even by the demigods or great sages, and certainly not by those who are unintelligent like animals. Neither the demigods and sages nor the unintelligent can understand the features of the Lord, nor can they express in words his actual position. May that Supreme Personality of Godhead give me protection. Purport, a similar understanding was expressed by Kunti Devi. The Supreme Lord exists everywhere, within and without. He exists even within the heart. Sarvasya chaham hridi sannivishto ishvara sarva bhutanam hridisher junachishtiti. Therefore, it is indicated that one can find the Supreme Lord within one's heart. There are many, many yogis trying to find him. Dhyana vastita tadgatina manasa paschanti yam yoginaha. Nonetheless, even great yogis, demigods, saints, and sages have been unable to understand the bodily features of that great artist, nor could they understand the meaning of his movements. What then is to be said of ordinary speculators like the so-called philosophers of this material world? For them, he is impossible to understand. Therefore, we must accept the statements given by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. When he kindly incarnates to instruct us, we must simply accept the word of Lord Ramachandra, Lord Krishna, and Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and follow in their footsteps. Then it may be possible for us to know the purpose of their incarnations. Janma karma ca me divyam evam yo veti tatvataha tyakvadeham punarjanma naiti mam eti sorjuna. If by the Lord's grace one can understand him, one will immediately be delivered, even within his material body. The material body will no longer have any function, and whatever activities take place with the body will be activities of Krishna consciousness. In this way, one may give up his body and return home back to Godhead. So in Rupa Goswami's Namashtakam, he says, Brahma sakshat krita nishchayapi vinasham ayati vinana bhogai apati nama Brahma sakshat krita nishchayapi I'm a little rusty on this verse. Yep, Brahma sakshat krita nishchayapi vinasham ayati vinana bhogai apati nama spuranena tat te prarabdha karmeti virauti vedaha. And in this verse, Rupa Goswami describes how that normally one who meditates on the impersonal feature of the Lord will attain liberation after some time, but one must go through the experience all of one's karma, both good and bad, till it burns out. However, one, he says, yet brahma sakshat kriti nishyapi vinasham ayati vinana bhogai apati nama spuranena tate spuranena. If one just gets a spurti, or one glimpse of the pure holy name of the Lord, in chanting the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, there are three stages. There's the offensive stage, the clearing stage, and the stage of pure chanting. And in the offensive stage, we're covered by clouds of material desire and ignorance. And therefore, we can't experience the effects of the holy name. But as those clouds begin to clear, the rays of the sun of the holy name begin to come through. And they have the transformative effect on the devotee. And when the pure holy name shines through, then all of one's karma is eradicated, even prarabdha karma. Spuranena tatu prarabdha karmiti viroti vedaha. All the Vedas, Rupa Goswami said, are saying this, that even the prarabdha karma becomes destroyed. How then is it that a devotee would continue to live? Because if your prarabdha karma is finished, it means you no longer have a material body, because this body is made of prarabdha karma. And Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur explains in his Madhurya Kadamani that the Lord maintains the prarabdha of the devotee so he can go on preaching and spreading Krishna consciousness. So it may look like somebody's walking around in the material body, but who's come to that perfectional stage, but actually it's being maintained. It's in a different situation. Therefore, in the nectar of instruction, Drishvaisa Bhava Janitarva Pushashta Dosha, Na Prakritafamiha Bhakti Dhanasya Pashyat Gangam Nasam, Na Kalabud Budapena Pankar, Brahma Dravapamapagachati Nira Dharmai. Rupa Goswami says, one should never criticize a pure devotee, no matter if that person seems to have an infirm body or an ugly body, and so forth, because it's transcendental. So just like the Ganga, sometimes there's bubbles, foam, and mud. But a person who's spiritually advanced goes like this, pushed out of the way, and then takes the bath, right, in the Ganga, knowing that it's coming from the toe of Lord Vishnu. So, let's hear any reflections so far from what you've heard from the purports. Anything that stuck out for you? Because these will be important things. In hearing, as you go on hearing, you'll pick up various things that really make an impression. And those impressions accumulate over time. Gandharvika.
It's just, it really, Prabhupada, how he says that one should offer prayers. And it was just, we had a seminar on power of prayers, I think the three-part seminar. I was just remembering how even when we offer these prayers, it also depends on our level of realization we have in Krishna consciousness. So even if we go for material desires that the prayer promises, still Krishna frustrates the desire with which we offer the prayer. And then because we don't have any other option, we continue to recite the prayer until we come to the point where we say the prayer to please Krishna. So was just thinking how it's all just the attitude with which we offer the prayer. Even we say a small prayer, we can make a tremendous progress just by saying one prayer with the right attitude to please Krishna. Means otherwise Krishna just frustrates it until we come to that point. So I think we should continuously pray that we constantly be in that situation which is very difficult. And that was one point. And another point I was just thinking is how Gajendra is in this situation that death is coming to us at every moment, and Prabhupada is again and again stressing, and we also discuss it in almost all classes, but we become so much overwhelmed with Maya if our life situations are very nice. So I really like the point how you said that by using intelligence we can feel the sense of urgency, because sometimes the situations may not be always we are in a miserable condition, because the good things will also come. But how do we maintain the sense of urgency in that situation? So I like the point when you said that through our intelligence we should do that. So those are the two things that really impressed me.
Thank you very much. I'll comment on the first thing that you said about prayer. And considering the statement Prabhupada makes in the Bhagavad Gita, in his commentary to the verse, Shri Prambhavati Dharmatma, Shashvashantuminagachati, Kontiya Pratijanihi Nami Bhaktiya Pranashati. There he says, one who's engaged in Krishna consciousness will very quickly become righteous. And that he tells Arjuna, you should declare boldly, my devotee is never vanquished. In that purport, Srila Prabhupada says that he asks the question how it is that one may, who is a pure devotee, may intentionally, unintentionally, or even intentionally commit sinful activity. And then he goes on to talk about how the remedy for all the anomalies that we experience as we're going through this lifetime is to continuously chant Hare Krishna. And in the Padma Purana, there's a verse which recommends that whatever unsteady state one's in, one may be in a sinful state or chanting offensively, that means praying without the proper motive or the wrong attitude, as you're pointing out, nama parada yuktanam naman yeva harantyagam avishrani prayuktani name varta karanicha. That is, the Padma Purana says, if you're offensive in chanting, you should go on chanting without stoppage. Same advice. Because for one reason is that Krishna is responsive. When he sees you're endeavoring, even though you may have impure attitude, that you're going on trying, he's responsive and he'll help to purify you. And also, the quality of the holy name is so powerful that the dim light of the holy name, even if one is chanting in Namabhas, trying to clear, and that's the stage of clearing, is one's conscious that I'm offensive and I'm trying to stop. From that position, one will get so much benefit from the chanting of the holy name that one will gradually be elevated by the power of chanting the holy name. So one should go on. And that's what Krishna says in a verse you alluded to that we discussed many times in this class, all the way since Charnock and Union Avenue. And that is that it's nice, we keep moving from place to place, but we keep saying the same stuff. and we'll go on. I mean, it's the same kata. We don't care about necessarily about the place we're in. We care about the vibration and the kata. But he talks about how when one's faith, jata shraddha makatasu nirvina sarvakarmasu, that verse, in which one's faith is awakened, one knows that touching the material world is objectionable, but still he can't leave it alone. Krishna says, go on practicing. And you can repent inwardly, but be happy because you know, the reason you'd be happy is because you know if you continue, as you continue, you'll come to the professional stage. And at some point, you should also. shouldn't dally and claim that at no point will I ever become steady or qualified. You should become steady and qualified at some point. Stand on your own two feet, because that's also not a good position to hang around the edges and say, you know, some other time. I know that may sound contradictory, but there is some impetus that we have to display also. Other reflections, yes.
So I also like the second part of...
Who is that? Who is that?
Maharaj, this is Preeti Radhika, Danvat Pranam.
Hare Krishna.
Maharaj, should I wait my turn?
Please go ahead.
Yeah, Maharaj, I really liked the portion where you said that Krishna knows the last vestiges of our what is holding us back, and we all have our shortcomings, and we all have our drawbacks, but Guru and Krishna, in all their mercy, they know what we need and what shortcut we need or what a push we need. So I really like that analogy where you said that somebody's going into the lake but touching with the toe, but then somebody just suddenly pushes them. So I think it's Guru that kind of gives you that push, because he knows exactly what kind of push we need. So I really like that. Thank you, Maharaj.
Yeah, thank you. And just, I was appreciating that you like the fact that Krishna knows what the last vestiges are and that he'll wring them out of you. It's nice to, it's a good position to be in, that you appreciate that, because some people don't. Some people would try to insulate themselves from that. I heard, I don't know if it's just an urban legend or something, that in some homes in India, they don't, Krishna doesn't have a flute. Because they say if Krishna has a flute, then, and you hear it, that means you want to give up the material world, something like that. So they say, Krishna's here, but he's not getting a flute. It's sort of like that verse from Rupa Goswami where he says, don't go down to the Jamuna, because if you see him, you're never going to go home again. And so there could be that way in which I try to insulate myself. Okay, let's have a few more. Thank you very much, Preeti Rao. Oh, right, you were up, Shraddha, go ahead.
I was just going to add on to both what Gandharvaik Madhi said and also Preeti Radhika. So that particular words actually helps also in explaining why good, bad things seem to happen to good people. Because a lot of people always ask that, you know, I started taking to devotional service and now why bad things are happening to me.
Yeah, it's really good and bad depends on your goal. You know, if your goal is to make some soup, then having a hammer is not a good thing. But if it's to nail, put a nail in the wall so you hang a picture frame, it's good to have a hammer. So if whatever happens to us, we just interpret it according to our frame of reference, and we say, that's good, that's bad. It's why is it good or bad? It's because my goal is to have some bodily comfort or whatever. But others, they appreciate. It's like, oh, good, this helps me become free from the bodily conception of life, and they take it as Krishna's mercy. So it has to do with that more than anything else. It's completely subjective, our experience here in the material world. Another point. Unnecessary necessities is the mantra you're taking away, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
And second, japam paramam japyam.
Japa paramam japyam. That's a good one. Yes. Sundar Ananda. Japa paramam japyam.
I like the words that you quoted. I don't know from which source, but by Rupa Goswami, who says about when the holy name of some of the holy name rises in your heart, then it dissipates the cloud of karma, and not even just prarabdha karma, but also prarabdha karma. Actually.
Yeah, namashtakam. Number 5, I believe, right? From the Namashtakam, Brahma Sakshat Kriti Nishchayapi Vinasham Ayati Vinana Bhogai Apaiti Nama Spuranina Tate Prarabdha Karmeti Virauti Vedaha. It's all in the Vedas saying that.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Yes, Malini.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, thank you so much for the wonderful lecture. the part that where Gajendra was remembering the previous prayers from his previous birth, and how Krishna was put him in that position so that he can get rid of that last thing. And I was also reflecting that even in this life, what happens next in our life, actually, if we see Krishna is directing us everywhere we go. I just remember that last Saturday we went out on Sankirtan, and we were distributing Bhagavatam set. One house we met and they took, and after that we went to two consecutive houses. They were from Jain, they are Jains, Gujaratis, so they both said no. And then we just stopped at that point, and then we said, let's pray to Lord Narasimha Dev. And then we actually remembered the prayers, what Srila Prabhupada was mentioning, Ito Narasimha, Bharato Narasimha. And then we actually really cried out, and we were remembering Narasimha Dev. And the very next house we went, Krishna was directing. We met a very nice family. She was a doctor, and she had two sons. And one of them was so sharp and intelligent that after he had his dinner, he came over and we showed him the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam and all the pictures. And the moment he saw the picture where Parikshit Maharaj was actually putting a snake around Shramika Rishi, and he saw the picture and he says, you said he was putting a snake around the neck, but I see two snakes in this picture. And then I was also puzzled for a moment, you know, where are the two snakes you see? And there was Parikshit Maharaj's bow, which is in the shape of a snake. And there's a, because he was putting the snake with this bow, it looked like a snake. And then he just noticed immediately within just few just seconds. And then he saw the assembly where Parikshit Maharaj, when the snake came to bite Parikshit Maharaj, he noticed that, you said it was a snake, but this snake has wings. How come? And he was asking those questions, and the sages assembly was asking, who is this? So what is he doing here? Why is he sitting? What does he want to learn? And the questions he was asking, and he was so inquisitive. And we were about to leave, he said, no, wait, let me, please explain this picture to me. Please explain this picture. He didn't want us to leave. Actually, we also didn't want to leave, but it was getting late. And he saw one of the devotees and he said, I think I saw you before. It felt like it was some kind of impressions that he had from his past experiences or something, that he was grasping everything so quickly, just as if he already knew, he has already been there. And when he said, I saw you before, we were just thinking, maybe in your previous birth, we don't know. But how Krishna was directing that they get a set of Bhagavatam and they sit down and read with their family, and how he recognizes pictures. It was amazing. It was just nice.
The act of going out on book distribution brings alive the Bhagavatam. One gets to see it reflected back every day. One goes out and mixes with people and sees what their reactions are and so forth. And it's such a transcendental activity also that Krishna within the heart is giving intelligence about where these kinds of things are coming from, the impressions that they have and so forth. And in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, pass it back to Harivamsa Prabhu. In the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, Rupa Goswami says that the qualification to take to bhakti is shraddha, and that shraddha for bhakti comes from association in previous lives with devotees. Even one's natural inclination to perform devotional service in a certain way comes from this kind of connection with devotees. Harivamsa.
Thank you, Prabhu. Wonderful class and nice comments, question, answers. I really like the point which you recently mentioned, that at some point we have to stand up. We cannot be on the edge. Because if I may use this word right, jaded, there may be a tendency of, because of overwhelming things, we can become jaded and maybe mentally procrastinate our resolve to stand on our feet. And thank you for stressing that. I was just remembering how Radhanath Maharaj quoted that verse in the Amal Bhakta Swami Maharaj's initiation ceremony, Etam Sasthaya Paratmanishtha, that yes, I will do it by the mercy of Krishna, as all previous acharyas have done. And Krishna also says, Bahava Jnana Tapasa, that many people have perfected and followed it. So that is like a North Pole star. We can always keep in mind that, yeah, otherwise how will other people, the humanity in general, follow this process if we are not having that resolve that yes, we are ready to stand up. So thank you. It's a very, thank you for repeating that again.
What was the first part you said? The very first part?
Become jaded.
Jaded, yeah, that word jaded. Sometimes people think it means a piece of worn out piece of jade or something like that. But a jade is an old horse that's been run so many times, worked so many times, that he's just worn out. And he's set in his ways. You know, new horses, you can train them in certain ways and they have some enthusiasm. And an old horse, so jaded. Just kind of adds new, a little light to what you were saying. Thank you for the points. Yeah, that one's determination to make advancement in devotional service is because Krishna's responsive. If we make that prayer and we have that determination, then he will give us the intelligence and facility to do that. Yes. Japa paramam japyam. Also, paramakshara krite, the supreme combination of syllables. I think about that sometimes when I sit down to chant mantra because the mind's going, now what are you doing again? Why are we doing this again? And paramakshara krite, this is the supreme combination of syllables. And one can have faith in the acharyas, as is being mentioned. But just have faith in the acharyas. Point is, you're going to have faith in somebody somewhere. Your professor at school, the newspaper, the government, some famous athlete or something. Every living entity takes shelter somewhere. So the Shastra keeps saying, take shelter of the acharyas and follow what they say, because the mind needs that kind of direction. Etam saastaya parahatmanishtam yasitam purva tamar maharshivya ham tarishami durantaparam tamo mukundangri nisheva yaiva. I shall cross over the insurmountable ocean of material existence by being firmly fixed in the service of the lotus feet of Krishna. This was approved by the previous acharyas who were fixed in firm devotion of the Lord, Paramatma, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Follow the acharyas. Shraddha, we got 2 minutes. For the internet comments.
Sure. Thank you, Maharaj. This is Sri Janavi from Denver, Colorado.
Wow, nice.
The story of Gajendra reminds me of the need to develop the mood of total dependence on Krishna. It is best to practice this mood during all the days of ours, so that when the difficult times come, that sense of dependence will be natural.
What a nice observation, isn't it? So let's try that. Developing, cultivating a sense of dependence on Krishna and constant surrender. Then when those severe occurrences come, it'll be a natural way in which one takes shelter of Krishna. Deal?
Yes.
Deal. Okay, yeah, that's our deal. We just take shelter of Krishna and the previous acharyas and accept wholeheartedly what they say and their path, and that makes our progress clear. Vanchakal kripasnabe vacha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo.